안녕하세요. 우리는 이제 계속해서 이제 캐시 그의 구조에 대해서 이제 배우고 있고, 아마 오늘 수업에서 이제 캐시 부분이 이제 마무리가 되고, 이제 버추얼 메모리 에 대해서 이제 아마 들어갈 것 같고요. 그 버추얼 메모리까지 이제 끝나게 되면은 이제 메모리 하이러키, 그다음 메모리 시스템의 그 기본에 대해서는 이제 마무리를 짓게 됩니다. 어쨌든 이제 어려운 상황이지만은 그래도 그 비디오 강의로 이제 계속해서 한 2주 정도 이제 좀좀더 공부를 하고, 그 다음에는 이제 아마 기말 시험을 볼수 있지 않을까. 학교에서는 이제 기말 시험을 오프라인으로 이제 보는 것이 이제 방침으로 정했고요. 그래서 뭐 지금까지는 뭐 오프라인으로 보는 것으로 저도 이제 생각을 하고 있습니다. 예, 어쨌든 한 학기가 이렇게 끝나게 되네요. 저번 시간에 이제 우리는 그 캐시 메모리 구조에 대해서 이제 조금 더 이야기를 했고요. 그 다음에 이제 캐시의 그 어소시에이티비티, 사실 한국말로 어떻게 해야 될지는 잘 어떻게 번역이 되어 있는지는 잘 모르겠지만, 어쨌든 어소시에이티비티, 그 캐시 어소시에이티비티에 대해서 우리가 이제 배웠습니다. 그래서 어소시에이티비티는 이제 캐시에서 뭐 중요한 그런 뭐 부분 중에 이제 하나이기 때문에 뭐잘뭐 이해를 하면은 좋을 것 같습니다. 뭐 잠시 이제 리뷰로 이제 하자고 해보면은, 어쨌든 우리가 이제 메모리 하이러키를 이제 공부하면서 우리가 항상 생각을 해야 될 거는 메모리의 이제 퍼포먼스. 메모리의 이제 퍼포먼스가 컴퓨터 전체의 그 퍼포먼스에 미치는 영향이 굉장히 크다라는 것을 여러분들이 항상 생각을 해야 된다는 거. 뭐, 그래서 뭐 지금까지는 뭐 CPI 이런 그 퍼포먼스 메트릭을 이제 계산을 할때 사실은 그 메모리 시스템의 영향에 대해서는 우리가 고려를 하지는 않았죠. 그래서 이제 우리가 이제 프로세서를 이제 리뷰를 해보면은 프로세서에 이제 들어가는 메모리 이제 컴포넌트가 이제 두 개가 있었죠. 메모리 유닛이 그 인스트럭션 메모리랑 그다음에 데이터 메모리가 뭐 있었고요. 그다음 사실은 이제 요 인스트럭션 메모리랑 데이터 메모리가 실제로는 뭐였죠? 그 레벨 1 인스트럭션 캐시, 그 다음에 레벨은 데이터 캐시라고 했습니다. 우리가 이제 사실 그 프로세서에서 그 CPI를 계산할 때 로드 인스트럭션이나 스토어 인스트럭션 같은 경우에는 ST죠. RISC-V는 여기서 이제 그 메모리 스테이지에서 그 이런 메모리 인스트럭션이 이제 소비하는 시간은 항상 우리는 한 클락으로 생각을 해서 계산을 했습니다. 근데 요거는 어느 때다? 캐시 힛 케이스. 그러니까는 데이터가 캐시 메모리에서 레벨 1 캐시에서 발견될 경우에만 이 부분이 이제 성립을 하고요. 실제로는 데이터가 이제 캐시에 있을지 아니면은 로우 레벨 캐시나 아니면 메인 메모리에 있을지 우리는 알수 없기 때문에, 만약 이제 미스가 발생하게 된다고 하면은 어떻게 되죠? 미스가 발생하면은 그 메모리 인스트럭션이 그 메모리 스테이지에서 이제 소비하는 시간이 한 클락 이상 뭐 소비를 하게 되겠죠. 뭐 이런. 그래서 이제 그런 그 메모리 스토어 사이클을 이제 계산하는 식을 우리가 이제 저번에 이제 배웠고요. 그 다음에 거기에 이제 기초를 해가지고, 그 다음에 만약 메모리 그 캐시 미스가 우리가 고려가 되었을 때 실제로 그 퍼포먼스가 어느 정도 우리가 이제 저하가 되는지를 또 계산하는 방법을 우리가 저번에 이제 이그젬플로 이제 다루었습니다. 어쨌든 인스트럭션 캐시도 이거 메모리이기 때문에 캐시 미스가 이제 발생할 수 있다라는 거. 물론 이제 캐시 미스 레이시오는 뭐 데이터 캐시보다는 좀 낮게 됩니다. 왜냐면은 인스트럭션 같은 경우에는 뭐 기본적으로 이제 세퀀셜하게 있는 그런 패치를 하는 그런 비헤이비어가 대부분이기 때문에, 인스트럭션 캐시 같은 경우에는 뭐 대부분 그 most of cases, 그 miss ratio, miss rate가 그 데이터 캐시의 miss rate보다는 좀더 낮게 이렇게 나오게 되겠고요. 그 다음에 이제 데이터 캐시의 miss rate를 계산을 해가지고 우리가 이제 additional 그 캐시의 miss penalty에 따른 그 더해진 증가하는 CPI를 어떻게 구해야 되는지를 우리가 이제 다루게 되었습니다. 뭐 인스트럭션 캐시 같은 거는 뭐 저번에도 막 저번 시간에 말을 했지만은 모든 인스트럭션은 인스트럭션 캐시를 액세스를 해야 돼요. 그렇기 때문에 모든 인스트럭션에 대해서 계산이 되어야 되고요. 그다음에 데이터 캐시 같은 경우에는 그 메모리 인스트럭션만 액세스를 하게 되는 거죠. 그래서 이제 데이터 그 메모리 액세스 데이 그그 뭘까? Fraction of the memory instruction을 우리가 곱해줘 가지고 요 miss penalty를 계산을 해줘야 됩니다. 그 다음에 또 하나의 이제 그 메모리 시스템의 이제 퍼포먼스 메트릭으로 우리가 average access time을 우리가 계산을 할 수가 있다라고 했죠. 그 메모리를 액세스할 때두 가지 케이스가 있기 때문에 hit 이벤트가 있고 그 다음에 miss 이벤트가 있기 때문에 그 hit과 miss를 나눠가지고 우리가 계산을 해줘야 되는 거고요. 그 다음에 그렇기 때문에 miss까지 고려해서 그 amen, average memory access time을 계산을 하게 되면은 hit time에다가 miss rate multiplied by miss penalty 이런 식으로 equation이 나온다고 우리가 계산을 할 수가 있습니다. 네, 그래서 항상 메모리 시스템이 퍼포먼스에 미치는 영향은 굉장히 크다. 예, 특히나 이제 요새 뭐 어떤 시대라고 하고 있죠? 빅데이터 시대라고 이제 할 만큼 메모리 그 데이터의 사이즈가 굉장히 크기 때문에 요 데이터 메모리 시스템이 데이터와 메모리 시스템이 전체적인 그 컴퓨터 시스템의 퍼포먼스에 이제 미치는 영향은 지금 현대에 와서는 더 크리티컬하다라고 여러분들이 뭐 생각을 하면은 되겠습니다. 사실 그래서 우리나라 인더스트리에는 사실은 뭐 좋은 방향이에요. 왜냐면은 한국은 뭐 프로세서를 설계를 해서 뭐 수출하기보다는 아무래도 메모리를 만들어서 수출을 하는 그런 나라기 때문에 뭐 메모리 인더스트리가 좀더 강한 스트롱한 그런 뭐 나라고요. 그렇기 때문에 그 메모리 퍼포먼스가 전체 컴퓨터 시스템의 퍼포먼스에 많은 영향을 미칠수록 사실은 우리가 메모리 그 영역에서 그 연구를 하고 그다음에 이득을 얻을 그런 가능성도 좀더 이제 증가를 하게 되겠죠. 자, 그리고 이제 어소시에이티브 캐시에 대해서 사실 우리가 저번에 배웠는데요. 이 부분은 사실 이제 중요한 부분입니다. 캐시의 어떤 컨피규레이션에서 그 어소시에이티비티는 굉장히 이제 중요한 부분이고요. 뭐세 가지를 이제 배우긴 했지만은 기본적으로는 N-way set associative 이걸로 우리가 기본적으로 그 associative 캐시를 이해를 하면은 뭐 되겠습니다. 그래서 N-way set associative 캐시는 뭐냐? 어쨌든 캐시의 원 셋에 더 많은 블락을 우리가 저장을 하겠다라는 것이 아이디어가 그 멀티웨이 셋 어소시에이티브 캐시, 그러니까는 어소시에이티브 캐시 아이디어라고 이제 보면 되겠습니다. 그러니까 보통은 우리가 이제 그 다이렉트 맵 캐시로 캐시의 컨피규레이션 배우는 걸 시작을 했는데, 뭐 다이렉트 맵 캐시는 그 인덱스로 이제 캐시 블록을 액세스를 하고 하나의 인덱스가 가리키는 부분에 태그가는 데이터 한 캐시 블록이 한 개만 저장을 하고 있죠. 그래서 하나의 인덱스가 가리키는 그런 영역에 캐시 블록을 하나만 저장할 때 이걸 우리가 다이렉트 맵드 캐시라고 이야기를 하고 있고요. set associative 캐시, 뭐 그러니까 멀티웨이 set associative 캐시 같은 경우에는 멀티플 블록 멀티플 캐시 라인즈를 저장을 하는 케이스가 그 멀티웨이 셋 어소시에이티브 캐시라고 여러분이 이제 생각을 하면 되겠습니다. 그러니까 멀티 그러니까는 멀티플 블록을 저장할 수 있으면 이득이 무엇이냐? 뭐 말을 했 저번 시간에 이제 이야기를 했듯이 하나의 셋에 디퍼런트 태그를 가지고 있는 그러니까는 태그의 개수를 멀티플하게 저장을 할수 있다라는 것이 장점이죠. 그러니까는 뭐랄까 프리 레벨 오브 프리덤이 좀 증가를 해야 된다라고 할수 있겠습니다. 한 셋이 있을 때그 우리가 한 셋에서 가용할 수 있는 뭐그 블록의 개수가 증가를 하는 거기 때문에 뭐좀더 자유롭게 프리리 그 캐시 블록을 한 셋에 이제 더 저장할 수 있는 그런 장점이 있습니다. 그래서 이제 우리가 이그잼플에서도 이제 볼수 있듯이 그런 이그잼플 뭐 이거는 굉장히 심플한 이그잼플이긴 하지만 그 어쨌든 어소시에이티비티가 증가를 할수록 미스 레이트는 떨어지게 돼 있어요. 그렇지만 뭐다? 단점은 뭐 퍼포먼스가 좋으면 비싸집니다. 항상 모든 세상 일은 그렇고요. 그렇기 때문에 이제 멀티웨이 셋 어소시에이티브 캐시를 우리가 적용하게 됐을 때 우리는 컴퍼레이터가 좀더 많이 필요하게 되고요. 그렇기 때문에 캐시를 만들기 캐시에 이제 캐시를 만들 때 이제 필요한 코스트가 좀더 이제 증가를 하게 됩니다. 또한 이제 캐시를 한번 액세스하게 될때그한그한 셋에 저장되어 있는 그 멀티플 블록을 모조리 액세스를 해줘야 돼요. 모조리 비교를 해야 되고 또 읽어와야 되고 뭐 그렇기 때문에 그만큼 그 파워를 또한 많이 소비를 하게 됩니다. 그러니까는 뭐 어드밴티지는 뭐였죠? 뭐 퍼포먼스 상으로 퍼포먼스가 어드밴티지가 되겠고요. 네, 디스어드밴티지는 역시나 코스트 이거는 뭐그 임플리멘테이션 코스트도 이제 해당되고 그다음에 파워 컨섬션 코스트도 이제 좀더 많이 소비가 되게 됩니다. 뭐 그렇기 때문에 우리는 이제 적당한 그요 그러니까는 뭐 코스트도 고려를 하고 퍼포먼스를 고려를 해가지고 뭐 적당한 그 레벨의 그 셋 어소시에이티브 캐시를 이제 적용을 해야 되는데요. 그거는 우리가 이제 시뮬레이션을 통해서 그 캐시 미스 레이트를 관찰을 하고 그 관찰되는 그 트렌드에 따라서 그 어소시에이티비티를 우리가 이제 결정을 하게 됩니다. 그러니까 뭐 트렌드를 이제 보게 되면은 우리가 그냥 뭐 풀리 어소시에이티브 캐시가 가장 좋긴 해요. 그냥 좋긴 한데 그렇지만 우리가 그 어소시에이티비티를 증가를 한다라고 해서 그 퍼포먼스가 캐시 퍼포먼스가 리니어하게 증가를 하진 않습니다. 약간 그 여기 나오는 결과처럼 그 세츄레이션 되게 돼 있어요. 뭐 그럴 때 무작정 어소시에이티비티를 늘리기보다는 어느 정도에서 타협을 하는 거죠. 네, 이런 식으로 이제 설계를 해야 되는 거고요. 그다음에 그 example에 대해서도 제가 또 이렇게 예를 들어서 설명을 했습니다. 그래서 이 example를 보게 되면은 하나 인덱스가 가르치게 되는 부분이 이게 이제 원 셋, 어떤 셋 캐시의 셋이 이제 되겠고요. 한 셋에 여기는 지금 4-way 지금 셋 어소시에이티브 캐시죠. 그렇단 말은 한 셋에 캐시 블록이 4개가 들어갈 수 있다. 4블록스를 저장을 하게 되는 거고요. 그렇기 때문에 한 셋을 우리가 캐시를 액세스를 하게 되면은 셋 인덱스에 따라 가지고 어떤 캐시의 셋을 이제 액세스를 이제 하게 되는데 그러면은 이제 각각의 그 태그를 셋에 저장된 태그랑 요 컨트롤 빗, 밸리드 빗을 읽어와서 우리가 찾는 리퀘스티드 데이터가 캐시 안에 이제 존재를 하는지 안 하는지를 비교를 해서 캐시 안에 존재하면 힛 아니면 미스 뭐 이런 식으로 우리가 판단을 하게 되는 거죠. 그래서 요 구조랑 우리 전에 배웠던 이 구조를 이제 비교를 해보면서 무엇이 다른지 한번 살펴보는 것도 뭐 좋은 공부가 되겠습니다. 그래서 리뷰를 여기까지 했고, 오늘 공부를 또 이제 진행을 해보도록 하죠. So in the previous class, we discussed about the associativity of cache memory. So set the multiple associativity of cache memory means that in the one set of the cache, multiple blocks can be stored. That means that in the one set, within the one set of the cache, then multiple tags can be stored. So if we use the higher level of associative cache in the as the with for the cache memory, then we can increase the some level of freedom to store the data in the cache memory. So that is the advantage of the multi-way set associative cache. But as I said, the cost of cache cost is the disadvantage of the multi-way set associative cache. So let's talk about the replacement policy. So what is the replacement policy? So if we use the multi-way set associative cache, then we need to consider how to replace the cache blocks in a single set. Why? So in a multi-way set associative cache, multiple cache blocks can be stored. So for example, in the four-way set associative cache, so in a single set, the four cache blocks can be stored. Like it's a set, so four cache blocks can be stored. So that means that if the cache is accessed for this a certain cache set, then these four blocks can be stored by the valid data. So cache blocks are, or all cache blocks in a single set can be occupied, and then next the new request is requested to the this set, cache set. Then how can we replace the cache data? That is the cache replacement policy. So obviously, if we use the direct method cache, then we don't need to consider about the replacement policy. It is because in a direct method cache, actually one set of the direct method cache can store single cache block. So if the new request is given to the this cache set of the direct method cache, then this valid block should be replaced. Actually, there is only one block, so we don't need to consider about the replacement policy. But how about the set associative cache? In the set associative cache, then there are multiple blocks. Then we need to select which blocks will be replaced by the new request. So what's the matter? So here there are block number 0, block number 1, block number 2, block number 3. And then new request is given to this set. Then we need to replace the one of these four blocks. So how can we select the replaced block? So evicted block. So this, if the block is removed from the cache memory, then this event is called the eviction. So eviction means that a block is removed from the cache. So if all blocks in the in a set is totally occupied, then and then new access is given to this set, then one block should be evicted from the cache. But the cache memory needs to select which blocks will be evicted. That is the replacement policy. So let's talk about the set associative cache. So if there is the invalid block, then we can use the dead space. That's obvious. So invalid block means that in a cache block, some block is not occupied yet. So in a cache block, these two blocks are occupied, but these two blocks are invalid. So that means that This block and this block is not occupied yet. So in this case, we can fill we can occupy this one of invalid block for the new cache accesses. But how about the if the all cache blocks in a single set is already occupied, then we need to select the which blocks will be evicted. So we need to choose among the entries in the set. That is the very important decision in the cache memory. So actually, there are many replacement policies, but in this course, I will introduce the two replacement policies. The first policy is the least recently used LRU, and this policy is called the LRU, and then this policy is the actually most famous replacement policy in a cache memory. So what is the LRU replacement policy? So as we can see in the name of the LRU, like least recently used, then this LRU replacement policy means that if the one block is least recently accessed, is used, then this block is replaced. So what does that mean? So there are four blocks in a single set, and all blocks are occupied, but this is block number 0, 1, 2, 3, and then this block is accessed means that it can be read, it can be read, or it can be written. So this block is accessed and clock cycle number maybe 7, and then this block is accessed and clock cycle 10, it's 100, and then this is the clock cycle 50. So what is the least recently used block? It's a clock cycle number. So and then the currently the clock cycle number is the 150. Let's also split the current clock cycle number is the 150. Then what is the least recently used block? This block, because this block is accessed the long time ago of the current clock cycle. So based on the LRU replacement policy, this block should be replaced. That means that if new request is given to this set, then this cache block 0 is evicted from the cache, and then new data occupies this block number 0. And then new clock cycle footprint is recorded on this block. So actually, if the request is given on the clock cycle number 150, then this clock cycle footprint is recorded in this block. So then after this event, what is the least recently used block? And then the block number 1, because it is accessed clock number 10. So this is the some reasonable policy. And then so least recently used this replace policy is the most famous cache replacement policy. So this LRU replacement policy is the reasonable cache replacement policy. And then if you see that this policy, then it is very simple. It looks very simple, but you know, when we consider about the hardware implementation, this LRU replacement policy is not always easy to implement. So actually, if for the two-way set associative cache, this LRU replacement policy is very simple. This is because when the cache block is accessed, then we can recently accessed, then we can set the flag for the recently accessed block for the actually two-way set associative cache, and then it is manageable for the four-way set associative cache, but there are four blocks, then we can actually apply to some very simple tree-based algorithm for this four-way set associative cache. But for example, it's an 8-way or 16-way set associative cache. This LRU replacement policy is hard to implement. So actually, if there are 4-8 blocks, and then if we record the clock cycle footprint on the cache blocks, then it's not easy to find some smallest cache clock cycle number on the cache block. So actually, for the that is manageable for the four-way set associative cache, but it is hard to implement for the some higher level set associative caches. So sometimes the hardware vendors use the pseudo LRU replacement policy, but this policy will not be introduced in this course. So, and then the second way is the random policy. So it's so random policy is just to select some block to be replaced randomly. So it's a random. So this performance of the random replacement policy is actually similar to the LRU for the high associativity. So is it reasonable? So it doesn't sound reasonable, but the performance is very similar to LRU for the high set associative cache. So and then also we can organize the cache memory as the multi-level cache. But I frequently mentioned the multi-level cache in the previous classes. For example, if the data is not found in the level 1 cache, then the data is requested to the low level cache. Then this low level cache means that level 2 cache, this is level 1. And then if the data is not found on the level 2 cache either, then the data is requested to the actually low level cache, so that means the L3 cache. Or if there is no L3 cache in the computer processor, then the data is requested to the main memory. So this is the multi-level cache topology. So with this multi-level cache, actually this level 2 cache is also fast, but it's slower than the level 1 cache, but size is larger than the level 1 cache. And how about the DRAM? For DRAM, this level 2 cache is faster than the DRAM or main memory, but the size of level 2 cache is smaller than the DRAM. So level 2 is some intermediate shows the intermediate performance or intermediate cost compared to the level 1 or main memory or some level 3 cache. But what is the benefit of this multi-level cache topology? So if we use the level 2 cache inside of the CPU chip, then it is faster than the DRAM, but the size of the level 2 cache is larger than the level 1 cache. So that means that you can reduce the miss rate with the level 2 cache. So if we can reduce this miss rate with the level 2 cache, then if the data is provided from the level 2 cache, then this data can be fetch the level 1 cache with some intermediate delay. So that is the benefit of the level 2 cache. So with the level 2 cache, we can reduce the some miss rate for accessing the level 3 or DRAM memory. We can reduce the miss rate, but the access latency is much faster than that, actually much faster than the DRAM. So primer cap, so it's a level on cache, actually it's a very, so the fastest but smallest in the memory hierarchy. So actually the register file is the fastest and then smallest and then most expensive. But so register file is the part of the ISA, instruction set architecture. So we frequently think that the level on cache is the highest level of the memory hierarchy, located the highest level of the above memory hierarchy. So fastest and smallest, and then for the level 2 is a fast and small, the size is small, but compared to the main memory, that is a fast, and then size is small, but we can reduce the miss rate to the main memory. So larger, slower, but still faster than main memory. That is the advantage of multi-level to cache and multi-level cache. So some high-end system, so here in the slide mentioned that some high-end systems, but recently the most of desktop processors has the multi-core architecture. So actually in a single core has the in a Intel x86 or AMD x86 desktop architecture, the single core has the level on cache, level on instruction, and then level on data cache. Also, the single core has the level 2 cache. And then there are multiple cores in the chip. And then this processor chip has the shared level 3 cache. This size of the level 3 cache is larger than this level, private level 2 cache. So that is the some common architecture of the desktop CPU, the recent, the modern desktop CPU. Okay. So let's see the performance with the multi-level cache example. So let us assume that the base CPI is the 1, and then clock rate is 4 gigahertz. 4 gigahertz, so it's a clock frequency, and then miss rate for the instruction cache is the 2%, and then main memory access time is the 100 nanoseconds. So in this case, we only consider the miss event on the instruction cache. So if there is only level on cache, then if the instruction is not found in the level on cache, then the data is requested to the main memory. So the main memory access time is the 400 nanoseconds, that is the 400 clocks, right? Because the clock rate is the 4 gigahertz. So miss penalty is the 400 cycles. So effective CPI is the 1 plus 2% multiplied by 400 cycles, then it's the 9. But if there is level 2 cache, then let us assume that the access time is the 5 nanoseconds. So compared to the level on cache, the access latency is not shown here. So let us assume that the access time of the level on cache is the 1 clock cycle, equivalent to the 1 clock cycle. But so for the level 2 cache, the access time is slower, so 5 nanoseconds. But what's the miss rate? Global miss rate to the main memory is the 0.5%. So that means that miss rate is lower with the level 2 cache. Because it is actually obvious, because the size of the level 2 cache is larger than the level 1 cache. Then what is the miss penalty to the level 2 cache? So this is the primary miss with the level 2 hit. That means that the data access to the level 1 is missed, but then the data request is given to the level 2 cache, but this request is hit in the level 2 cache. Okay, what's that? So if primary miss with the level 2 hit, then the penalty is the 20 cycles. Then what is the penalty? So then what is the penalty, miss penalty of the level 2 cache? Then let us assume that the what is your 500 cycles? So let's see the primary miss with the level 2 miss. So in this case, why is the extra penalty is 500 cycle? I don't know, but it should be 400 cycles because I think that is the typo here. So because the main memory access time is the 100 nanosecond, so the penalty is the 400 cycles to access the data from the main memory. So the CPI is the 1 plus 0.02. That is the miss, and miss it is the miss on level 1 and then hit on level 2. Then is the penalty is the 20 cycles. So and then what is the this case? This is the miss on level 1 and then miss on level 2. So in this case, data should be accessed from the main memory. So that is the 400 cycle. So the actual CPI for this multi-level cache is the 3.4. The performance is improved by 2.6 times. That is the benefit of the level 2 cache or the multi-level cache. So the primary cache focus on the minimal heat time. So that means that the heat access time is small, very small for the primary cache. That means that it's a level 1 cache. So and then for the level 2 cache focused on the low miss rate. So actually I said that the size of a level 2 cache is larger than the level 1 cache. So the level 2 cache focus on reducing the miss rate of level 1 cache, miss rate on the data access. So to avoid the main memory accesses. So that is the some purpose of the level 2 cache to lower the miss rate to avoid the main memory accesses. So level 2 cache is usually smaller than a single cache. What is a single cache? And the level 1 block size is smaller than a level 2 block size. So that is the some design trend of the level 1 and level 2 caches. Why the level 1 block size is smaller than the level 2 block size? Because in order to reduce the access time. And then let's think about some advanced process architecture with some memory systems. Actually, in the previous chapter, we discussed about the out-of-order processor. So the 5-stage pipeline architecture is the in-order processor. So then that process with the in-order processor, if the memory instruction is stuck on the memory stage, so that means that the memory request to the data memory data cache is missed. So the memory instruction is stuck on the memory stage. That case. So in the case, the following instructions should be also stuck on the pipeline stages. So it's a pipeline stall event. But in the out-of-order processor, if the following instruction is independent with this memory instructions, then these following instructions can be executed even though the memory instruction is stuck on the memory stage. That is the out-of-order processor. So actually the performance of the memory hierarchy with this out-of-order processor depends on the characteristics of instructions and then some data dependency, observed in the instructions, and then the some, also the some configuration of the out of the process, like some size of the load buffer or the size of the reservation stations. So actually, it is very hard to estimate the estimate the performance of and performance of the memory system. Also, it is hard to estimate the some impact of the memory impact of memory system performance on the out of order processor. So it's much harder to analyze. So we frequently use the system simulator to measure or to estimate the performance of a computer system with the out of order processor. Okay. Okay. So interactions with software. Actually, this the miss rate is highly dependent on the some access patterns of the software. So that means that so based on the some software algorithm, then the miss rate is also very highly influenced. Okay, so. So this graph shows the some different algorithm of the sorting algorithm, and then based on the this sorting algorithm, and then you can find the different cache miss ratio with the what's that? This miss ratio. What happened? This miss ratio with the different sorting algorithm, and then also. Actually, this sorting different sorting algorithm also. Affect the performance of the software also. So actually that is obvious. Okay. What time is it? And then also let's say the some software optimization technique for considering cache size or some memory hierarchy. So that is the example of the DGEMM code. So that actually that this application performs the matrix multiplication. I believe most of you already know about the matrix multiplication. That is the middle school mathematics level, right? Like this is large matrix of A and multiply by large matrix B, and then we'll generate the some large matrix of C. So DGEMM, this application performs the this matrix multiplication. So this is the some kernel, the inner loop of the this DGEMM, so matrix multiplication software. And then I believe you can easily understand the, this kernel code of the DGEMM. Then what is the issue of the this DGEMM and the cache or the memory hierarchy, cache memory. So how can we perform the matrix multiplication? So this is the middle school mathematics. So in order to calculate this element, then how can you calculate? We need to perform the multiplication for this element of the matrix A and matrix B, and then this element of the matrix B, and then here. So we perform the multiplication for the this six element, and then perform the add operation, accumulation. So this is the accumulation part. So in order to calculate this element, we need to perform the six multiplications and then accumulate one accumulation. So, and then for the next element, this calculation is performed for the same row of the matrix A, and then next column of the matrix B. So, and then Actually, I believe most of you know how to calculate the matrix multiplication. So, in order to calculate this part, these three elements, then the computer processor needs the one row of data of matrix A, and then three column of data of matrix B, right? Then, what is the issue? So, if this whole matrix can be stored in the cache memory, then we don't need to fetch some data element of matrix B for main memory, then, right? So, if the cache memory can contain the one row of matrix A and the entire element of matrix B, then this computation will be performed very fast because all data exists in the cache, exists in cache. But that is the ideal case. If the size of matrix is very large, then all element of the large matrix cannot be stored in the cache memory because the size of cache memory is very small compared to the main memory. So, if some element of the large matrix is accessed from the main memory, then that will degrade the performance of the application. So that is some optimization technique of the software considering the memory hierarchy or memory systems. So how can we improve the optimized? How can you optimize the matrix multiplication? So we can apply some submatrix multiplication. So this submatrix can have the smallest matrix size. So the large matrix can be split into the multiple submatrix, and then the matrix multiplication can be applied to these small size of submatrices, and then it is merged for some entire result. So that is some optimization technique for the matrix multiplication, and this is some sample code. So with this optimization, then the size of the matrix is reduced, and then this smaller size of matrix can be entirely stored in the cache memory. So that is, as you can see, that is some performance of unoptimized matrix multiplication code, and then is the blocked matrix multiplication code, and then this is the size of the matrix. For the unoptimized code, this the performance of GPLOPs. So this is the floating operation per second. Like giga is the 10 to 9, so floating operations per second. Then for the unoptimized version, the performance is degraded by the size of the large size of the matrices. So for the small matrices, the performance is the 1.7 gigaflops, but for the large matrix like 960 by 960, the performance is less than half of the small matrices. But with the optimized calculation software, sometimes the blocked matrix multiplication is applied to the optimized version, then we can see that the performance is very similar to the small size of a matrix calculation. So performance is slightly reduced, degraded, but we can see that the performance degradation is small, but with the blocked version. Okay, so this example shows us some lesson that we need to consider about optimization of the some large size of linear algebra application considering the size of the cache memory or some characteristics of memory hierarchy. That is the very important lesson in this example. Okay, the cache is done, and then I will give you a pop quiz for this week. So there are three questions on the pop quiz, today's pop quiz. And then I will give 2 points for this last. That's the last question, question number 3. What kind of locality, and then what kind of memory, and then size of the field as in the cache. It's very simple questions. Okay, I think it's it. I gave enough time. Okay. Before going on the next topic, the virtual memory, then I will show some interesting data regarding different types of memory. So this figure shows the latency of the different types of memory technology. So you can find many different types of memory technology like DRAM, Optane memory. This is the 3D XPoint memory developed by Intel, and then RAM disk, and then Optane applied to the PCI bus, and then NAND flash memory. And then NAND flash memory on the SATA bus, hard disk drive, and then zip drive, and some different kinds of storage devices. So, do you know about the 3.5 inch floppy disk drive? Okay. And then the x-axis shows the access time, the average access time. And then note that this average access time is the log scale. So that means that it's about 10 times, so it's 10 times for the every unit on the x-axis time, and then this is the some percentage of the latency, so like 0 to 100%. Actually, this is called the tail latency. So for the large event of the access to the different memory component, then we can find some different access latencies. So this y-axis shows the some percentile of the total access time, like 0 to 100%. So if the clock frequency is the 4 GHz, then its access time is actually flat. So if the clock frequency is the 4 GHz, then it's the 250 picosecond there's latency. And then for the L1 data cache is nearly 1 nanosecond. L2 is slower than the L1, the L3, and then it's about the 10 nanosecond. And then how about the DRAM? DRAM is about 60 or 70 nanoseconds, but so as you can see, the access time for the DRAM is the very slow than the Leveron cache. How about the Optane? Optane inserted on the DIMM slot. This string X point memory isn't very fast, but it's slower than the DRAM. But what is the some unique characteristics of this Optane memory? This string X point memory is the non-volatile memory, but DRAM is the volatile memory. That is the difference. And then if we use the RAM disk, then it's the some technique to use the DRAM space for the some DRAM space like disk drive. So it's a RAM disk technology. So interestingly, the latency of the RAM disk is slower than the Optane DIMM because this 3DX point memory is handled like a main memory. And then if the Optane memory is used as the storage device connected to the PCI bus, then this latency is about the 10 microseconds. So compared to the DRAM, it's like less than 100 nanoseconds. This 10 microseconds is about 100 times slower than the DRAM, right? And then for the NAND flash memory is 10 times slower than the Optane memory, so 3DX point memory. And then if the SATA version NAND flash memory, so how about the HDD? It's the RPM of the hard disk drive, so it's very very slow. And it's a zip drive, slower than the HDD, 10 times slower than the hard disk drive. Then if you floppy disk drive, very very slow. So you can find some different access latency of the different memory technology. Okay, let's talk about the virtual memory. So this is the some this topic is related to the main memory and the storage, and then you can find that some interesting terminal term virtual. So what does that mean? It's not real memory. So what is the some opposite term of the virtual? Physical. So in the computer system, the opposite term of the virtual is the physical. So actually, the physical memory. So we frequently mention physical memory. So that means that this physical memory is the real main memory. Then what does that this virtual memory? What does the what does that virtual memory mean? Some unreal memory. So let's talk about this virtual memory topics. So the idea of the virtual memory is to use the main memory as a cache for secondary storage. This secondary storage is actually the secondary storage means the storage devices such as HDD or SSD. Then what does this cache mean? So cache is the temporary storage, memory component. Cache is the memory component to store the data temporarily. So what does that mean? This main memory as a cache. So actually, we know that the storage device is very slow, but the size of storage device is much larger than the DRAM. So actually, the DRAM is compared to the this storage devices, the DRAM is much more expensive, and but it's actually fast. So actually, it's very expensive. So actually the first virtual memory idea is to use the DRAM memory as the cache for storage spaces. So that means that this DRAM space is small, but The computer system can use the part of storage space as like such a, like a main memory. So how can we manage that this some large space of main memory located on the storage? So if we can use the this DRAM space as the cache, similar to the cache memory, then if the some part of data is frequently accessed, then this data is stored in the real physical memory, physical DRAM memory. And then if the some data is not frequently accessed, then the data is stored in the hard disk or some storage devices. So that is the some idea of virtual memory that use the DRAM memory as a cache. So this virtual memory is jointly managed by the CPU hardware and the operating system is a software. So actually the virtual memory is also the hardware need to support the virtual memory. So it's called the memory management unit. Also this virtual memory is managed by the operating system, by the software. So this is the some initial idea of the virtual memory. But so actually the main benefit of the virtual memory is the this programs share the main memory. So what does that mean? So this is the some physical memory space, and then multiple programs can be running on the processor concurrently. Then how can we manage the, this memory space with the multiple programs? So let us assume that this program 1 is accessing the memory address 0x0010. And then program 2 may want to access the same memory address, but it's a different data actually. So actually the physical memory size is different for the some different computer systems, because some certain computer system may have the 1 gigabyte physical memory, or some other computer system may have the 4 gigabyte of the main memory, like DRAM memory. So that means that the computer system has the some different size of the main memory, and then also the different program may need to access the some same space of the memory, main memory, like 0x, like this with the same address of the data. But the data can be different, because that is the different program. Data can be same, can be the same, or data can be different. So how can you handle this? So if actually if the data is different, and then the different data is accessed by the different programs, then the address should be also different, because the data is different. So in this case, the program 2 need to access the different address, like here. But problem is that the space of the memory, the DRAM space is different for the different computer systems. So it's very hard to manage this address of the programs on the different computer systems. So how can we handle this problem? So we know that the operating system runs on the computer hardware. This operating system manages the computer hardware, some different configuration of the computer systems. So operating system already knows how the memory is managed, or the size of the physical memory on the computer system. So different program can access to some its own memory space, but the operating system can translate this memory space defined by the certain program to the some physical memory space on the computer system. That is also the, some virtual memory idea managed by the operating system. So, program use the virtual address for the for accessing the certain data, and then this virtual address is translating the address of the physical memory, and this address is called the physical address. So it's the some real address on the real memory. So this translation is managed by the operating system. This is because the this memory space is also managed by the operating system. Also, operating system already knows which part is assigned to the a certain program, also which part is occupied by the another programs. So this is the idea of the virtual memory. So it's a virtual memory to the physical memory translation. So, and the CPU and operating system translate the, this virtual memory, virtual address to the physical address. So, physical address is the real address on the physical DRAM. The virtual address is the some address defined on the, in the program. Actually, this virtual address is managed by the compiler. So, actually, this is the some static information, but the physical address is dynamically translated from the virtual address of the program. Okay, and then so this translation is done by the operating system and supported by the CPU hardware and operating system. So this virtual memory block is called a page. Okay, and then if the, this block is not located in the inside of the physical memory, and then this event is called the miss. Actually, because the main memory is used as the cache of the storage devices, so this event is actually miss on the main memory, and then this event is called the page fault. So if you are interested in the computer system, then you may have heard about the some terminology page fault. So this block is called the page, and then this event is called the page fault. Okay. So this is the some introduction of the virtual memory. So then may be hard to understand because it is the it's not some real operation. Actually we only consider some real data access on the physical memory until now, but actually in the computer system, this address of the program is translated into the some physical address. It's a real address on the physical memory. So it may be difficult to understand, but it's a very like a good idea to manage the multiple programs running on the computer system. So it's a very important topic. So you need to understand about the virtual memory. Okay, so I will stop here, and then in the next class I will discuss about the virtual memory in more detail. 수고 많았습니다. 네. 다음 시간에 사실 virtual memory라는 것이 약간은 이해하기 어려울 수가 있는데, 왜냐면은 우리가 이 데이터가 이제 physical address로 directly access 되는 것이 아니라 프로그램은 그냥 자기 컴파일러가 지정해준 virtual address로 동작을 하는데, 그거를 오퍼레이팅 시스템이 피지컬 메모리로 바꿔주는 거예요. 그 트랜슬레이션은. 물론 이제 하드웨어도 서포트를 하긴 하지만 이런 매니지먼트는 오퍼레이팅 시스템이 합니다. 그래서 이제 실제적으로 이게 뭐랄까 트랜슬레이션을 왜 해줘야 되는가? 뭐 여러 가지 장점이 있습니다. 근데 말했듯이 오퍼레이팅 시스템은 하드웨어로 매니지를 하기 때문에 다이내믹컬리 이거 매니지를 하기 위해서는 이런 트랜슬레이션이 있으면은 굉장히 이제 좋습니다. 예. 그래서 이제 다음 시간에는 그 버추얼 메모리를 좀더 디테일하게 이제 설명을 하겠습니다. 예. 수고 많았습니다.